Today, I will be talking about how we can interface qubit with classical systems. With classical, I mean systems which are non-quantum, so not exploiting quantum effects. In order to understand how we do it, let's look at how a real-life quantum computer looks like. Basically, there is the quantum processor, where the qubits are, and you've seen implementation of qubits for a quantum processor in other videos. In order to control these qubits, you need an electronic interface to drive the operation of the qubits, for example, single qubit or two qubit operations. At the same time, you also need to read out the state of the qubits, and this is done also by the electronic interface. In order to be a little bit clearer about what this entails, let's look at a number of examples. For example, let's assume we have a qubit implemented as a spin qubit using a single electron, and you would like to rotate this qubit. What you need to do is generate a magnetic field which can interact with the magnetic dipole of the electron. Do that, we can think of putting a wire next to the qubit and let a current flow through the wire so that the magnetic field is generated that can interact with the electron. To do that, we need to generate a certain microwave pulse with a certain amplitude and duration at a frequency tuned to the resonance of the electron, so that the qubit can rotate as we want. Now, the amplitude and the shape of this pulse will determine how the qubit exactly rotates. So you can see, by applying a purely electrical signal, we can apply a single qubit rotation in the quantum processor. So that's an example of control. Let's look now at an example for the readout. Again, let's talk about the spin qubit using a single electron. This time, we want to read the magnetic dipole of a single electron. That is very difficult. So, what people do is that they make sure that the information in the magnetic domain is translated into information about the position of the electrons. So, by appropriately timing the quantum processor, we can make sure that, depending on the quantum state, the qubit moves to a different position or not. That change in position can be sensed by a charge sensor next to the qubit. Now, how do we read this charge sensor? Basically, we read the charge sensor by reading its resistance. The main idea is to connect an electrical circuit to such resistor to read its value. Here is a typical example of what is used in a typical setup. You connect the charge sensor to a coaxial line, and you inject power at the precise frequency in that coaxial line. If the resistance has a certain defined value, this power will be absorbed by the charge sensor. Otherwise, if the resistance is different, this power will be reflected back and detected by a low noise amplifier. So, what we see here is that a quantum phenomenon, the state of the qubit, is completely translated to an electrical signal that can be read out by using classical electrical circuits. So, all of this is embedded in such electronic interface that you see here in the VUL system. But how does this look in real life? If you come to one of our labs at QuTech, you will see something like this. We have a big refrigerator, this big cylinder hanging from the ceiling, 2 meters tall. This is used to cool down the quantum processor very close to the absolute zero, because that is the temperature where the qubits work best. The quantum processor is here, at the bottom of the fridge. And to find the electronic interface, we should follow the wires that go through the fridge to the top floor and finally reach the electronic equipment on the higher floor, which implements the electronic interface. A quantum computer today looks like this. You have the quantum processor at very low temperature and the electronic interface at room temperature composed by very bulky equipment. The question we want to ask ourselves is, can we scale up such a system to a very large number of qubits? Now, you can understand that it's not so simple, especially because of the wiring. If you want to build a quantum computer with practical application, you need millions of qubits, and thus millions of wires. As an analogy, think to the camera in your phone. It has millions of pixels, and you try to connect each of those pixels with a wire 2 meters long to its electronic readouts. This is not something we do today because it's not very practical. The same is true for a quantum computer. This approach here is not practical. So, a much better solution is to build electronics on purpose for this application, tailor-make it, and bring such electronics also at very low temperature that we can connect to a very large quantum processor, so that we can build a scalable quantum computer. Our approach is to bring the electronics very close to the quantum processor. Here you see the quantum processor cooled to a temperature between 20 and 100 millikelvin, and the electronics placed very close to it. So on the top part of the figure, you see the electronics that we use to read out. So you see some amplification, some frequency down conversion, and then you need to convert these analog signals to the digital domain through analog to digital converters, or ADCs. These digital signals are processed by the digital control unit, which determines what to do with these readout states and decides what to feed back into the quantum processor. That's done with the digital to analog converters, which brings back the signal to the analog domain, eventually upconverting and amplifying it back into the quantum processor. One thing you may realize is that we may also need to bring some part of the electronics at the same temperature of the qubits, so down to 20 millikelvin. But if we can do that, we can really build a scalable quantum computer. As a side note, here I'm showing a purely electrical interface, but for some qubits, for example NV centers, we may also need an optical interface, possibly also working at cryogenic temperature. Now, to implement all that, we have to face a number of challenges. First, all of the electronic controller needs to achieve very tight performance. If you think to the example of the spin qubits, just to let the qubit exist, you need to provide constant voltages with a very tight stability, well below 1 microvolt, which means better than 1 part per million. We need also to provide microwave pulses with very tight accuracy in terms of amplitude and timing. And you need to build a readout with very low noise, much better than what is possible today, while at the same time avoiding any kickback. That means avoiding any effect back to the qubit, because you want to avoid spoiling the quantum state. So that's the first challenge, meeting the performance. The second challenge is that you have to operate these electronics at cryogenic temperature. So typically, you want to place it in a refrigerator. You see a simplified diagram on the right. The refrigerator has different stages at different temperatures. The qubits are typically placed at the lowest stage at the lowest temperature. And you want to place the electronics as close as possible to the qubits. What's the problem? The problem is that the lower you go in temperature, the less cooling power you have available in the fridge. So, for example, at 4 Kelvin, you only have 1 watt of power available. And if you go to 20 millikelvin, you even have much less than a milliwatt. So the challenge here is to build all these electronics while dissipating the minimum amount of power. Finally, but also very important, we need to build these electronics with a technology that can work at cryogenic temperature, as low as 4 Kelvin or even 20 millikelvin. You have different options, because you can use superconducting devices, or any semiconductor operating at low temperature. Here you see a number of examples. The challenge is to choose the best technology. So, to conclude this lecture, we have seen that we can build a scalable quantum computer if we can build an electronic interface operating at cryogenic temperatures, very close to the quantum processor. However, to make sure that this works, we have to address a number of challenges in terms of performance, power dissipation, and cryogenic operation. And these are the topics that we are going to discuss in the following video.